May it please the court. Again, my name is Darren Zane. I represent plaintiff appellant Michael Fuqua. I'd like to reserve 2 minutes for rebuttal. This case is yet another example where prison officials were able to violate Fuqua's RLUIPA rights with impunity. It shows exactly why Congress enacted RLUIPA and intended appropriate relief to include money damages in the first place. Fuqua was disciplined and fired for refusing to work during a religious holiday. Although the district court held that the defendant substantially burdened Fuqua's religious exercise, it found that it could not hold them liable under RLUIPA. The Supreme Court in Tanzen changed that. Tanzen abrogates...
Well, we don't... you know, in the prior case, we've sort of gone through those arguments, so maybe in this case we should focus on the issues that are different about this case, because it was a jury trial here. The judge actually let one claim go to the jury, and the jury returned a defense verdict. And then we have a number of other individual defendants who were dismissed at earlier stages that you're contesting. So maybe you should focus on the non-overlapping issues.
Yes, Your Honor. Turning to the facts of this case, I'd like to start with Defendant Clark, the defendant who went to the jury trial for its First Amendment claim. The court should remand, allow Fuqua's RLUIPA claim to proceed on the merits against Defendant Clark, because RLUIPA provides greater protection than the First Amendment. And the general verdict for Clark on Fuqua's First Amendment claim does not foreclose Fuqua's separate RLUIPA claim against Clark. RLUIPA is substantively different from the First Amendment and provides greater protection. It's well settled that RLUIPA may protect prisoners when the Free Exercise Clause falls short. This is evident in the Ninth Circuit case law in War Soldier v. Woodford, as well as Alvarez v. Hill. The jury only returned a general verdict. There was no special verdict form or interrogatories to tell what element the jury thought Fuqua failed to prove at trial. And it may very well be the element that doesn't overlap between RLUIPA as well as the First Amendment. In fact, plenty of evidence at trial supported the overlapping of elements between First Amendment and RLUIPA, including that Clark acted under color of state law, and Clark substantially burdened Fuqua's religious exercise. Evidence at trial showed that Clark had the authority to hire or fire inmate workers, shown through declarations from other prisoner workers, as well as that Clark had ample authority as kitchen manager to reschedule Fuqua's day to observe a religious holiday, and that Clark basically ignored Fuqua's request for a day off to observe Sabbath and completely ignored that request. And therefore, because RLUIPA provides greater protection and the general verdict does not tell us which element the jury found that Fuqua did not prove at trial, this court should reverse and remand.
What about the issue of qualified immunity for Starnes?
Yes, Your Honor. For Starnes, I think, again, the issue of qualified immunity as to the RLUIPA claim will be an issue of first instance.
Let's talk about the First Amendment.
For First Amendment, I would point the court to Williams v. Bittner, a Third Circuit case in 2006 that held it's well established that prison officials may not penalize inmate workers from their kitchen jobs for refusing to work that would violate his religious beliefs. In that case, a Muslim worker refused to handle pork at a kitchen prison, a prison kitchen, and it's the same case here. Fuqua refused to work during Sabbath in violation of his religious beliefs. Starnes, who was the kitchen supervisor, who all the other officials also told to talk to Starnes because he could, you know, talk about and get your day off, basically said, we don't do that stuff here. He took his request and says, you won't have a job here if you refuse to work during Sabbath.
So he was disciplined for not going to work on the day that he was scheduled. I don't think the record contains the precise policy that the prison relied on, and that it has for processing requests to have days off as a religious accommodation. My understanding is there is a policy that's specific for that topic. Am I right about that?
If Your Honor, are you referring to the 30-day notice where prisoners have to give 30-day notice for a religious holiday request? Again, Fuqua was only given 3 days notice when Francisco assigned him to the kitchen job. It was only 3 days prior to... So
I was getting to that point. So my ultimate question is, what was the basis for the prison denying his accommodation in this case? was it the timing that he was, that the prison didn't get 30 days notice, or was it that it wasn't given to the right person, or was it was not in the right form? What aspect of the policy did the prison specifically rely on in denying his request?
I think the prison chaplain, who was actually supposed to be the one who was supposed to approve that request, never filed a response. As for the prison officials, they basically ignored the request. They didn't give any basis. They just ignored his request, didn't do anything. Their inaction forced Fuqua to choose between his religious beliefs and his job. The prison officials didn't give a reason. They simply said, if you don't show up to work, you could be disciplined. And the prison policy they relied on is the kitchen allows them to discipline workers for any reason if they refuse to work. They relied on that policy to fire and discipline Fuqua despite him requesting for a religious exemption, which the kitchen and all other facilities in prison have long allowed such religious holidays to be reserved. Fuqua himself in different facilities in Arizona's prison system was granted Sabbath off to observe Sabbath in his previous job.
So then let's go to the qualified immunity question. And let's say for purposes of my question, there's at least a question of fact on a constitutional violation. Under qualified immunity, you also have to show that that violation was of clearly established law. We have precedent out there that says that prisons can have sort of general administrative policies and procedures for making these kinds of religious requests, and that's not a problem. That's not a barrier or an unfair burden. So what about this situation tells us that the violation was outside of that category and is clearly established to be a violation of the Constitution?
I think the best case would be Williams v. Bittner, which shows that they may not penalize a worker at the kitchen for refusing to work when it violates the religious beliefs. And I think Defendant Starnes clearly violated that well-established right when Fuqua went to him. He had the authority to change his schedule. Other prison workers offered to switch schedules with Fuqua, and he basically put him in an impossible situation where he said, I'm not going to listen to your request. You could either come here, show up to work, or you're fired.
Wait, and didn't Starnes say to go to the senior chaplain?
Yes, and Fuqua told Starnes that he did write a letter immediately to the prison chaplain, but he only had 3 days' notice. He hadn't heard back, so this was an emergency situation where
But what clearly established law tells a kitchen supervisor in a prison that he violates the Constitution if he tells the prisoner to go to the appropriate official within the prison who has authority over that subject matter?
I do not have a case law on First Amendment claim on those facts.
But then
facts.
Qualified immunity generally requires that there be, you know, clearly controlling authority, and so that's why it's different from the merits, and that's a problem on qualified immunity.
Yes, sir. There's no case law on that specific point, which I think brings it back to Defendant Clark, who doesn't enjoy qualified immunity. I'd just like to make the point that Defendant Clark, the district court held that does not, as a private contractor, does not enjoy qualified immunity under Ninth Circuit law, which means I think the court should still reach the core RLUIPA issue in this case. But as to the First Amendment claim, there is not a clear case law on that. I would still urge the court to remand as to qualified immunity for RLUIPA, because RLUIPA is a separate claim. It involves heightened substantive protections that may have this was not briefed before the district court, the qualified immunity issue as to RLUIPA. So I would still think that is a separate question than whether the officials are entitled to qualified immunity under the First Amendment claim. And unless your honors have other questions about the facts, I would reserve the rest of my time for rebuttal.
Okay. All right, so then we will hear first again from Ms. Bates. All right.
Good morning again, Your Honors. Rebecca Baines on behalf of defendants Francisco, Kamet, and Starnes. And I would like to leave at least 2 minutes for my colleague, Mr. Ayayama, to speak on behalf of defendant Starnes.
So you're, to clarify, you're counsel for just Kamet and Starnes?
As well as defendant Francisco.
And Francisco, okay.
Yes, and then defendant Clark is represented by co-defense counsel. The summary judgment in favor of Francisco, Kamet, and Starnes was proper in this case. I'll just briefly address Francisco and Kamet. And as the district court found, that these two individuals in particular had no personal involvement with the alleged violation of plaintiff's rights. Francisco, for example, was sort of the coordinator of the work inmate program. She was responsible for placing inmates, removing them from a roster if for some reason they were terminated, but not with the day-to-day scheduling, granting or denying requests for day off or discipline. And likewise, Kamet was responsible for providing security and for transporting inmates to and from their cells, but also had no actual authority or involvement with granting and requesting days off. And both of those individuals appropriately told Fuqua that he would need to take his requests up with the senior chaplain or with his kitchen supervisor. So those actions by them did not substantially burden Fuqua's rights. They didn't violate his RLUIPA rights or his rights under the First Amendment. So summary judgment was correct in their favor. And then as to defendant Starnes, while he was the individual who ultimately told him, when Fuqua on the day that he wanted a day off, told him that he would have to work or possibly face disciplinary action, he was acting in that case pursuant to the prison's policy, which said inmates, you know, had to put requests to a senior chaplain who was not defendant Starnes in at least 30 days in advance. So he was acting pursuant to that policy. And there is no case law, as Mr. Fuqua has said today, that establishes that his actions in doing that were a constitutional violation. And it is his burden to prove that the right at issue was clearly established. And we point out in the last section of our supplemental answering brief and in our original answering brief that there is case law out there that says conduct very similar to Starnes's here was not either a RLUIPA, but was not a RLUIPA violation, let alone a First Amendment violation. And while there may be some cases, or at least one case that goes the other direction, that's not enough for qualified immunity purposes, first of all, because...
Case you're referring to there?
Yes. So we pointed to the Snyder and Allen cases, which were out-of-circuit district court cases. And I think we also cited one other case. I apologize, I don't have the name on it. But the did hold that could be a RLUIPA violation of requiring an inmate to work on the Sabbath. But the point is that, first of all, they're all district court cases, which is not enough for qualified immunity purposes. And more to the point, they established that there is just not this robust consensus of persuasive authority that's necessary to clearly establish a right for qualified immunity purposes. And Fuqua has not been able to do that today. So for those reasons, qualified immunity was properly granted to Starnes. Summary judgment was properly granted. And unless this court has further questions, I think the record is clear on that. And we'd ask that the court affirm.
All right. Thank you, counsel. And so we'll hear now from Mr. Aoyama on the video.
Thank you, Your Honors. May it please the court, my name is Randy Aoyama. I am here on behalf of appellee Robert Clark. Robert Clark was the kitchen manager for Trinity Services Group. Trinity is a private company that provides food service for the Department of Corrections. As the court has mentioned, Mr. Clark prevailed in a jury trial on the appellant's First Amendment claim. So I think the first inquiry is whether there's any basis to overturn the jury's verdict on that claim. And I didn't see things from the briefing to suggest that there would be any basis to do so on the First Amendment claim. There was substantial evidence to support the verdict in favor of Mr. Clark. There was the testimony of Robert Starnes, Sergeant Starnes, testimony of Mr. Clark himself. So clearly there was sufficient evidence to show that for the jury to find that Mr. Clark did not violate appellant's First Amendment rights. Also, as I mentioned in the brief, the appellant did not challenge the sufficiency of the evidence in a post-verdict motion for judgment as a matter of law under Rule 50B. So that is another reason why there's no basis to overturn the jury verdict. With respect to the RLUIPA arguments, I mean, as I have mentioned in the briefing, we'll rely on the state's state defendants' arguments with respect to specifically respect to whether the RLUIPA authorizes individual capacity suits for money damages. We join in and rely on the arguments of the state on with respect to that.
Can you address the issue raised by your opposing counsel that if we were to conclude that Wood was not an obstacle to applying Tanzen to RLUIPA and the RLUIPA individual claim, there was a RLUIPA individual claim and then it had to go back, he contended that the jury verdict would not foreclose a RLUIPA claim on remand. What is your response to that?
I agree, Your Honor, that this was a general verdict and that there wasn't a special interrogatory to go into RLUIPA claims or elements. But what I would submit, Your Honor, is look if you look at the court record and if you look at arguments by appellant, everything, all the evidence and all the arguments are that Sergeant Starnes from the Department of Corrections had the final say on the hiring and firing of appellant. The and that goes along with their argument that that Sergeant Starnes was the one responsible for violating the RLUIPA or even First Amendment claims, was that it was all based on Mr. Starnes' decisions, and there's no evidence in the record to suggest that Mr. Clark had final say on hiring or firing decisions. Certainly Mr. Clark was not involved in determining whether the Feast of Trumpets was an appropriate holiday. Mr. Starnes did not have any Mr. Clark did not have any involvement in the disciplinary proceedings. So if you look at the evidence, Your Honors, there is no the only suggestion is that Mr. Clark had some influence or could make recommendations, Sergeant Starnes testified himself that he's the one that makes the decisions, and as you heard from counsel, Sergeant Starnes is the one who made the final decisions, and that's advanced by the appellant. So my response to that would be, if you look at the evidence that was presented at trial, and the only suggestion is that Mr. Clark had some influence, but there's no evidence that he had the final say. So that would mean, I think, that based on this record, the RLUIPA, if this court decides that RLUIPA may proceed against defendants, it should not proceed against Mr. Clark on this record. I thought I was going to have 2 minutes. I think I stated the things I planned on saying. If the court has any questions, I'm happy to answer them. Otherwise, I can return the time to Ms. Baines if she needs it.
All right. All right, thank you, counsel. We'll then hear rebuttal from Mr. Zhang.
Thank you, Your Honor. I'd like to first address Defendant Clark's trial. In Fuqua's pro se opening brief, he details reasons for why he would like to overturn the First Amendment claim trial, but this court does not need to overturn the jury verdict to hold that the RLUIPA claim should move forward, because RLUIPA and First Amendment have substantively different standards. The element in particular is the fourth element. Under First Amendment, as long as defendants act are reasonably related to a legitimate penological interest, that satisfies the First Amendment violation, but RLUIPA provides heightened protection. It provides akin to a strict scrutiny. And plenty of evidence at trial was shown to the jury that there was a legitimate penological interest for the prison kitchen to run 24/7. The jury heard ample evidence about how kitchen workers must be there. And so based on the general verdict, there's no way to tell which element the jury found that Fuqua failed to prove. And also just looking at the evidence at trial, plenty of evidence at trial also showed that Clark did have the authority to hire or fire inmate workers. I'd like to point to, Your Honor, to the FER pages 8 to 9, 27 to 28, or the Santos declaration, a declaration from another prisoner who said that he has seen Clark have the power to directly or indirectly hire and fire prisoners in the past. So I would submit that there's plenty of evidence that showed that the overlapping elements between the First Amendment and RLUIPA claim has been met at trial. And if, just using the rest of my time, I'd like to maybe briefly go back to the RLUIPA issue. I think the other side's primary argument is basically RLUIPA is not clear enough because it's a spending clause statute versus Tanzan talks about a RFRA, which is a non-spending clause statute. Again, Your Honor, there is no spending clause canon in the construction. Courts don't interpret the meaning of those words differently just because one statute is a spending clause statute and one statute is not. The other side has cited no case that supports that, and we're not aware of any case where courts have adopted a narrower construction just because a statute is a spending clause. That would be a radical departure from...
Counsel, it seems to me that this is not an interpretive issue that we're talking about, which is what we would be thinking about in terms of canons. This is a power question, and the extent of power that Congress has when they're acting under the spending clause versus some other authority.
Okay. And to that, I submit the other side does not dispute that statutes like EMTALA or Title 10 exceeds Congress's spending clause powers. And I'd like to also just point out the Sixth Circuit in Haight v. Thompson recognized such that there is no such a limitation would prove too much. It would be in contrary to all Supreme Court precedent on the scope of spending clause authority. The Supreme Court has never set a limit on spending clause powers that limits it to only state entities themselves that receive federal funding. All the Supreme Court case law on the scope of spending clause shows that as long as it bears some relationship to the purpose of the federal policy, it is within the scope. And RLUIPA's money damages remedy clearly falls within that. Money damages are not only appropriate, they are the only, sometimes the only remedy available. Without it, RLUIPA essentially is largely unenforceable. And for those reasons, we urge the court to hold that. Congress does have authority to enact such a statute, and not to read Wood has to have actually categorically limits Congress's spending clause powers. And for those reasons, we urge the court to reverse and remand for further proceedings for this case.
All right. Thank you, counsel. The case just argued will be submitted.